Hello everyone, this is Nitpicky Nerd, and today I want to review episode 4 of the online fanfiction sequel to Deep Space Nine, which is played by the original actors. I reviewed the first 3 episodes a few days ago, and now we have what apparently is the final episode, because the main story was kind of finished in this one. Even though there were a few hints of things to come, so maybe it's not the last one. I hope so, because I actually really enjoyed this. And I think episode 4 was much better than some of the previous ones, which I complained about in my previous review. For example, Sirok, who played Jake, his acting wasn't that good in the previous part. It seems to be kind of phoned in. And yet in this one it's much better, so maybe they get more comfortable, they get into the roles better. So acting-wise, I think episode 4 was much better, and even some of the plot details, they even corrected something I complained about in the previous review. I said that it was a mistake to say that Quark is still running a bar on the station when they made references to Star Trek Picard, in which in one episode they showed that Quark's bar is apparently a franchise, and so it didn't seem to fit their dialogue. But in this part they actually explained it. They said that Quark does have a franchise, but he still sits mostly at Deep Space Nine, because that's the place with the most movement, that's the place where he can hear things which he can make a profit from and all of that. And it does kind of make sense if Deep Space Nine is in a strategic place and with a wormhole and everything, so a lot of people still pass through that station, and if he wants to hear all kinds of information, then it would make sense for him to be physically there. And as for the other places, I think they mentioned he has 10 different locations on other planets, and he said that he has holograms of himself in those other locations, which actually fit one episode we saw in Deep Space Nine, in which he tried to create holograms of himself to run the bar instead of paying his workers, but all those holograms were glitchy. That's why it didn't work out, but that was a nice reference, and also kind of makes sense. And so they actually explained something I complained about in the previous review. There was a small continuity issue, not really a mistake, but something kind of a question mark I have about a story that Garak told Bashir about that time that he sabotaged that torture device that he was tormenting Odo with, that device that prevented him from becoming liquid and regenerating, and he said that he felt so guilty that he sabotaged it, and yet later on they could have used that technology against the changelings and maybe it would have helped in the Dominion War. I have a few problems with this line, because first of all, we saw in that episode he never sabotaged that device. He simply turned it off after Odo told him that he wants to go back to his people, and he realized that's the secret he was keeping, and so he simply shut off that device and stopped torturing Odo, and we never saw him sabotaging the device. And secondly, that whole fleet together with that device was destroyed by the Dominion. And Garak did barely escape, but he didn't have time to pick up that device anyway, so even if he didn't sabotage it as he claims now he did, it wouldn't have mattered if he couldn't get it. And also, I don't think it would have made a difference in the Dominion War, because as we know, thanks to Section 31, who infected all the changelings with a disease which prevented them from changing shape, and so they couldn't do much in the war anyway. They couldn't keep infiltrating other powers if they got sick. And so it wouldn't matter if he got that device or not, and so I found this line kind of interesting, but not really accurate. But as we learn in the end of this episode, Garak was basically faking it. He wasn't actually infected, he only said he was to motivate Bashir to help him, and in the end of this episode it turned out he was never infected himself. Which was a nice twist, and I liked it because it fits the character of Garak that we know from Deep Space Nine. He always did stuff like that, all kinds of misdirection. Like that time that he blew up his own shop so that Odo will investigate and find out who was going to kill him, because some people really did want to kill him, and so he actually blew up his own shop to get Odo to do what he wanted. And so it reminds me of that, the way that he motivated Bashir to help the Cardassians by pretending to be sick himself, and that disease causes you to tell all kinds of secrets. And so Garak, throughout these episodes, he told all kinds of little stories which tie to all kinds of background we have about Garak from the show, from Deep Space Nine. But in the end, it turns out it was all fake, and so technically everything he told in all these episodes about his background, it's still under a big question mark. So maybe that story about the device is also not accurate. And we also have Armin Shimerman in this episode show up as Quark, which was great, and he even wore the teeth that Quark always had. But it looks kind of creepy here because, you know, in the show itself, in Deep Space Nine, he was always wearing it as part of the bigger makeup, so he had the ears and the forehead and all that stuff around it, so it made the teeth not so noticeable. But here he's simply looking like himself, only with the teeth, and so he looks kind of creepy. I guess maybe he needed them for the voice to sound like Quark, so I guess it makes sense, but it was kind of creepy for a while. Maybe he should have wore some ears or something. Didn't he keep any kind of piece of the makeup? Didn't he keep something from it? And I think in the convention some of them did dress up as the Ferengi in a kind of a cheaper makeup, but it would have been nice to see him a little bit more in character. That would have been much more epic, but the teeth, I guess, were a nice touch. And he also mentioned that he owns a few moons, so that does fit. It's also something I complained about, that Quark always dreamed about owning a moon somewhere, and here they imply that he does own a moon, but he wants more. Like, I think he said his cousin Gela has 10 moons, and so he wants to get closer to that. So this really shows that no matter how much he gets, he still wants more. His greed is eternal. And that's great, and so I love that line, and it fixes what I was complaining about in the previous review. So I even wonder, maybe they listened to my review and they added that in, because it fits so perfectly into what was missing. And there was another reference to Star Trek Picard when Quark was talking about Mars. He said that in a decade the Federation will terraform Mars again to make it have an atmosphere, and that he plans to invest in it, and that he hopes it will become a vacation planet. So he wants to expand his franchise to that planet and so on. So that was interesting. And he was talking mostly with Jake. And then Jake again mentioned his novel. And that's something I was complaining about in the previous review, saying that you don't have to mention it every single time. Like, it, one mention of you being a novelist would have been perfect. But he has to bring it up again and again and again. And that's kind of funny. They also mentioned that he plays a Domjot and all of that. So there is a lot of attention to detail from the show, which is great. But in some places, it's like a little bit too much. Like, don't be repetitive. Don't repeat the same exact points again and again. And I think he mentioned that Jake has daughters. So that was nice. And then there was a touching moment when they talked about Nog. That they mentioned that Nog died. That the last time they all met was at his funeral. And of course it's sad because the real actor did die recently, and it was a nice touch in this episode when they were talking about it, and you can even see in their eyes like they were really emotional in that part. So it wasn't acting, they were actually talking about Aaron Eisenberg. And it's interesting how they included it in the story, and they actually used the idea that was in that documentary of Deep Space Nine, in which the writers of Deep Space Nine were talking about a theoretical season 8 of the show. And one of the ideas there was to start the show with Nog being a captain of the Defiant. He will come through the wormhole from the Gamma Quadrant, and suddenly his ship would explode, and Nog is dead, and then they have to investigate the mystery of what happened to Nog, who killed him. And I remember I was really annoyed at that idea. It was back when the actor was still alive, and so I thought they are killing him off for no reason, simply as kind of a shock value, simply as a plot element, but losing such an interesting character. So I was really annoyed at that, but shortly after the actor died for real, and so now I guess it fits because we cannot get the actor to play him again, and so now it kind of fits. Now it would be a good way to include it in the story and to explain what happened to Nog, and also to honor the actor. If you know, show some respect to the character dying and people mourning about him, you can also respect the actual actor. And so they did that a little bit here, and they used that same idea from that documentary, which I also made a review about, and I remember I was complaining about that point because the actor was still alive back then. And I like how in this fanfiction they kind of tie everything together. They use all kinds of references to the entire Star Trek franchise. They even made a lot of references to Voyager. They mentioned the fact that Voyager came back with technology from the future, but it was all locked down by the temporal investigations to prevent paradoxes and all of that. So they actually keep all that future technology under lockdown, and some of it might have gotten stolen by the Tal Shiar and all of that. So that was an interesting reference to Voyager. And they mentioned Admiral Janeway being furious that some of the technology was stolen and all of that. So there's a lot of really good references to the entire Star Trek franchise. So whoever wrote this did an excellent job, except for those few little bits which were questionable, which I mentioned. But 99% of it is absolutely perfect. You can see that whoever wrote this is a big fan of all the shows and all the movies. So the writing was really good. So that part in which Jake and Quark were talking about Nog, that was generally an emotional scene. And they mentioned that his ship exploded after returning to the Gamma Quadrant, so just like that season 8 idea. And that's also a seed of something that they might do later on. I hope so. It might be interesting. They mentioned that officially the investigation was closed, but Jake was not finished with his own investigation, and so that kind of leaves the door open for some future episode they might do, I hope so, to investigate all of that story. So maybe they will use ideas from that documentary of Deep Space Nine. One other idea they used was the fact that Bashir is now in Section 31, which I don't really like that idea. I guess technically it can work if they establish that he only joined them in order to do something good from the inside, something that no one else could do, and so I could buy this if it's written well, but so far it was just, meant to be cool or to please the fans and all of that, so I don't really buy it. And it wasn't really necessary for the main plot either. Like, the main plot is Bashir trying to cure the Cardassians who got infected by a virus made by Cobal, who was in the Tal Shiar. We saw him in one episode in season 7 of Deep Space Nine. And he actually played a Romulan agent even back in TNG, and he also played Silik, the Suliban. And maybe an interesting fan fiction would be to tie all these characters together to say maybe it was the same guy all along. That might be interesting. So, as I mentioned, there was a lot of really good references, and in the end of this episode, Bashir manages to cure the Cardassians, and then Garak reveals that he was pretending to be sick and he's actually not infected himself. That he staged all of it and that he actually used his own EMH as a double of himself whenever he was meeting someone so that he cannot be infected because he knew someone wants to assassinate him. And that really fits the character of Garak, who was always a very brilliant character, someone who was thinking ahead and all of that. So I love that twist. And also, there was some clues to it early on, back when he said that his EMH is not available, that it's missing, it's offline or something. So that was actually a clue to the final twist, and so I like it. It wasn't, it's not totally out of nowhere, and it also fits the character, and so this was a very good twist. So I think I covered most of it, so I really enjoyed this one. I thought it was well written and well acted, and I'm really hoping maybe they'll do some more in the future, and they did leave a few seeds of potential ideas for the future, such as Jake's investigation into what happened to Nog. That might be interesting. It might open a door to a whole new plot. So, very well done. I want to thank these actors again for spending their free time to do this for the fans. I don't think anyone paid them for that. They purely did it for the fans, and so I greatly appreciate it. If you didn't already check out that channel, they also have all kinds of videos of them just chatting with each other, and that's really interesting. All the actors from Deep Space Nine are just talking with each other, and maybe they would even respond to fan comments and all of that. So this is a nice way to actually talk with some of these actors from Deep Space Nine. And I always say, Deep Space Nine was an awesome show that deserved more respect. And so it's kind of a shame we never got a proper movie sequel or a mini series or something like that. But at least we have something. At least we have some of these actors actually playing and reading fan fiction and making like a sequel to Deep Space Nine as a gift to the fans. And it's a shame that Avery Brooks didn't show up in the end. I was hoping he would. Maybe they would do that in the future, even if it's just for a few minutes. Maybe Jake will get a vision from his father who will talk with him for a few minutes. Maybe if they do that sequel I was talking about, investigating Nog's death, and at some point he will contact his father who is in the wormhole and they will have a little chat with each other. That can be so good, and it wouldn't require a lot of time by Avery, so maybe he will do it in the future. I hope so. I think Sirok says that he's good friends with him till this day, so maybe he can convince him. I really hope they'll do that. And since we never will get an official sequel to Deep Space Nine, this is the best we can get, and so I really appreciate this and enjoy this. And so that's all I had to say about it for today. Let me know what you think in the comments below, and we can discuss it. And I will see you all next time. Bye bye.